the OnePlus 5T. Check out those slim bezels. The fingerprint reader moves to the back. Here's the 5T left compared to the OnePlus 5 right. It's a big improvement, packing more screen into the same size body. Other than the fingerprint reader, the back looks just like the OnePlus 5. In the top bezel, you can see a few sensors hidden away. The bottom bezel trades hardware capacitive navigation buttons for software buttons. The camera sticks out a bit. There's still an iPhone 7 style, dual camera arrangement. On the bottom you get a speaker, a USB-C port, and a headphone jack. One side has a volume rocker and a three-position volume switch. On this side is a power button and dual SIM slot. After launching the OnePlus 5 earlier this year, OnePlus is back with an end-of-year upgrade for the device. The OnePlus 5T takes a winning formula, high-end specs with a low price tag and a metal body, and reworks the front of the phone to dedicate as much space as possible to the screen. This device has a new screen, a new button layout, a new fingerprint reader, and a new camera setup. It almost feels like a totally new device. We liked the OnePlus 5 from earlier in the year, but with a more modern design, OnePlus has fixed OnePlus 5's biggest downside. The result is something that is extremely compelling, a $500 phone that makes you question exactly why you'd give $800 to those other OEMs when this has nearly everything the more expensive phones have. Design and build quality. There is so much to like about the OnePlus 5T hardware. The big addition is the new slim bezel front design. The OnePlus 5 shipped with a 5.5-inch screen, but thanks to the smaller bezels on the 5T, OnePlus can now cram a 6-inch display into a body that, give or take a few millimeters, is about the same size as the 5.5-inch phone. The bigger display in the same size body makes the OnePlus 5T feel like a major upgrade over the previous device. This new release looks more modern and makes better use of the front space. The change puts the OnePlus 5 teraseconds phone design on par with those $800 flagships. Specs at a glance: OnePlus 5T screen 2160x1086.01 401 pixels per inch, AMOLED OS, Android 7.1.1 Oxygen OS, CPU 8 core, Qualcomm Snapdragon 835 for 2.35 GHz Cairo 280 performance cores, and for 1.90 GHz Cairo 280 efficiency cores, RAM 6 GB or 8 GB, GPU Adreno 540 storage, 64 GB or 128 GB networking, 802.11 ABNIAC, Bluetooth 5.0, GPS, NFC bands, GSM 85,090,018,1900 MHz, WCDMA bands, 12,458 FDD, LTE bands, 1234578121718192025262829306 TDD LTE bands, 38,394,041 TDS CDMA bands, 3,439 CDMA VDOBC 0 ports, USB 2.0 Type-C, 3.5mm headphone jack, camera rear 16MP main camera, 20MP low light camera, front 16MP size, 156.1x75x7.3mm weight, 162 grams, 5.7 ounces battery, 3,300 mAh starting price, $499. Other perks: dash charging, three-position physical notification mode switch, fingerprint sensor, notification LED, dual SIM slots. With the bigger display comes a slightly bigger price tag. The OnePlus 5T is $20 more than the OnePlus 5. OnePlus seems to bump up the price of its phone every year. The company started offering a flagship-class phone with the OnePlus 1, which was only $300. The price creeped up to $329 with the OnePlus 2, then $399 with the OnePlus 3, then $439 with the OnePlus 3T. The $499 price is the highest ever, but flagships from the major OEMs have also jumped up in price for 2017. With the high-end of phones now priced at about $800 to $1,000, the 5T still feels like a bargain. The display is a 6-inch, 2160x1080 AMOLED panel. With a 189 aspect ratio, It's still a 1080p display, but this is a bit taller than the usual 169 aspect ratio. The display is built by Samsung, which is basically the only company that makes high-quality OLED panels for smartphones. The display looks great even in low lighting, and it doesn't have any of the weird artifacts present in the LG-made OLED panels that have been popping up lately. The OnePlus 5 teraseconds 401 pixels per inch PPI ISNT is outrageously dense as the 570 PPI Galaxy S8 display, but the many pixels really seems like overkill for regular smartphone usage. 500 PPI is great if you're strapping the phone into a VR headset, but for doing normal smartphone things, the display here is beautiful. Plus, at only 1080p, you should have slightly better battery life. In the upgrade from the 5 to the 5T, OnePlus has also fixed a strange scrolling effect that occurred in some devices. The community dubbed this jelly scrolling. OnePlus made an engineering decision to mount the OnePlus 5 display upside down and then flip the display orientation in software. This led to a funky, intermittent scrolling behavior that would somehow make UI components squish and stretch as you scrolled the screen. This year, the screen is mounted the right way and the scrolling should be normal again. To make room for the larger display, OnePlus is finally changing from capacitive navigation buttons that live below the screen to on-screen buttons drawn by the software. OnePlus old hardware buttons could have the functionality swapped around, but that also meant the buttons were totally unlabeled, which often got confusing. You can still swap the software buttons around, but now the labels move too. Switching to a slim bezel design means moving the fingerprint reader, so now you get a big, round fingerprint sensor on the back just like on a Google or LG phone. The sensor is center-mounted about 34% of the way up the back of the phone, putting it in a great spot to easily hit with your index finger. It's made out of ceramic, and I found it to be fast and accurate. The back still looks too much like an iPhone 7 Plus knockoff for our liking, although that is diminished somewhat with the relocation of the fingerprint sensor. The phone has an aluminum unibody, and the back is made completely out of anodized aluminum, save for the antenna bands on the top and bottom of the phone. A metal back is increasingly becoming a rarity as easier RF engineering and wireless charging pushes more and more manufacturers toward making all glass phones. With nearly all the $800 $1,000 phones save for the Pixel 2 switching to a fragile glass back, the OnePlus 5 teraseconds metal body is one of the best you can buy at any price. The one downside is that you don't get wireless charging, but it still always seems slow, finicky, and obsolete now that we have the reversible USB-C plug with super fast wireless charging. And speaking of charging, the OnePlus 5T still comes with OnePlus Dash charging. This is actually pretty neat. The heat-generating power management circuitry that normally lives in the phone is also duplicated in the power brick. When you're using a Dash charger, the power management circuitry in the phone turns off, and the charging setup does power conversion in the power brick. This means the brick gets hot instead of the phone, allowing the phone to charge optimally. This also really helps if you're trying to use the phone while it's charging, since a hot phone equals a slow phone. And remember, the power management is duplicated in the power brick so that if you don't have a Dash charger, a normal one will still work. On the audio front, there's a single, bottom-firing speaker that actually sounds pretty good. It's loud, clear, and better than you'd expect it to be. There's also a 3.5mm headphone jack. Still, there are a few items on the phone that fall in the indifferent category. OnePlus is again including its three-way hardware silent switch. You can slide between silent, do not disturb, which is just Android's priority mode, where you can choose which apps so people can make noise in this mode, and off. The switch does feel very well made, though, with a nice knurling pattern and a solid click action. OnePlus also developed its own version of Face Unlock, a feature Android has had since 2011. Obviously, this is aimed at the iPhone X, which ships with a fancy 3D face recognition system, but OnePlus is only using the front-facing camera for facial recognition. OnePlus admits that this feature is mainly for ease of access and ISNT as secure as a fingerprint sensor. It is very fast at times, if the phone is aimed right, and if the phone is in a good mood, you won't even see the lock screen when you turn it on. When even OnePlus won't vouch for the security of the feature, though, I'm not sure if I should be impressed or alarmed by such speed. If you want some legit hardware complaints, the phone isn't waterproof, and there's no expandable storage. That's about it, really. OnePlus has simply made one of the best phones of 2017 from a hardware perspective. The slim bezel design and Samsung AMOLED display is every bit as good as what you get on the $800 flagships, and the metal back makes the phone better than most $800 flagships. The OnePlus 5 was already great hardware for the price, but with the new design, the OnePlus 5T is great hardware at any price. Oxygen OS is the usual breath of fresh air, the lock screen, home screen, and app drawer. No major changes here. The notification panel, quick settings panel, and recent apps. No major changes here, either. The leftmost panel on the home screen shows a section for memos, recent apps and contacts, and a dashboard. Tap on the weather for a full screen forecast. On the right is the settings, which are pretty normal. The apps, like the calculator, clock, and file manager, look a little different, but all the usual functionality is here. There are tons of customization options. Here are the notification LED options. You can pick from two fonts, control gestures, or tweak the status bar. OnePlus software package called Oxygen OS should be the blueprint for what customizing Android means. OnePlus sticks to the same material design aesthetic that Android, the Google apps, and third-party apps all follow, but the company adds its own features and options. This is a much better approach than what you get on a Samsung or LG, as both companies reskin the entire OS to look like a totally different beast. Since you can't reskin the Google apps or third-party apps, however, applying a custom design to the core OS results in a fractured interface if the OS has one design style, and all the apps have another. OnePlus design definitely feels like the right way to go, allowing OnePlus to add features while still giving users a cohesive software product. As a result, the basic OS interfaces are pretty much unchanged from stock Android. The lock screen, notification panel, settings, and recent apps all function the way you would expect them to, with only a few minor tweaks from OnePlus. The home screen has a panel on the left side, which shows the weather, recent apps, and some device specs like storage use. This is super easy to replace if you don't like it. Similarly, the calculator, clock, and file manager all get custom OnePlus versions that don't feel that much different from stock Android. If you want, you can seek out alternatives in the Play Store. OnePlus loves to pack its OS with customization options, and if you dive into it, the OS settings, you can tweak a ton of stuff. You can fully customize what shows up in the status bar, showing or hiding things like the clock, auto-rotate status, Wi-Fi, and cellular network. You can set the battery to be the normal battery icon, a circle, or show a percentage readout. You can add seconds to the clock, or show the network speed in kbps. There are a number of options in the gestures settings, too. You can swipe down on the fingerprint reader to open the status bar, or use the fingerprint reader as a shutter button inside the camera app. If the screen is off, you can double tap to wake it or draw a letter gesture on the screen to open something. For instance, drawing AV on it turned or off screen could launch the flashlight. There are two system fonts to pick from, Google's default Roboto and OnePlus Slate, and you can customize the color of the notification LED. There's also a dark theme, which will recolor the OS and built-in apps, as well as a million other options. The navigation buttons feel totally messed up. They're too small, and the icon spacing is wrong. This feels more like a bug than a customization. You can customize some parts of the navigation buttons, but not the spacing. The auto hide mode is fun. It allows apps to take up the whole screen, and a swipe up will show the navigation bar. OnePlus software navigation buttons are really weird. The spacing is all wrong. OnePlus has them crunched together in the middle of the screen, almost as if the company made space for five buttons but decided only to draw the middle three. The spacing here doesn't seem like a preference, it just looks incorrect and ugly when the buttons are all squished together. OnePlus has done optional on-screen buttons in the past, and those were properly spaced, so why the change? OnePlus has 10,000 options for everything under the sun, except restoring the buttons to the proper spacing. There are some options for the on-screen buttons. You can add an optional fourth button on the left-hand side, which can hide the navigation bar, but that's it. The spacing on this fourth button doesn't make any sense either. It lives in the left-hand corner of the navigation bar, and it isn't equally spaced with the other buttons. There's an option to reverse the button order from the normal back home sense to a Samsung-style re-sense home back. You can also pick from a few double tap and long press functions for each button. Overall, I still love this software package. It's mostly additive to Android rather than trying to be a full replacement, a blueprint I wish more OEMs would follow. OnePlus customization route serves both types of consumers. There are those who want to tweak the phone to the heart's content, they can dive into the options and do so. And there are those who don't care, they can just ignore the extra options. OnePlus device support Outlook OnePlus Android update policy hasn't really changed from the OnePlus 5, which is to say, there is no official update policy. Even after asking OnePlus, we were told there's no promise of monthly updates, and there's no designated X years of support window. OnePlus reps we spoke to would only say to look at what the company has done in the past. So, let's say that OnePlus supported the OnePlus 2 with major updates for less than 1 year. The device, released in August 2015, did not get an update to Android 7.0 Nougat, which was released in August 2016. OnePlus does still ship quarterly security updates for the Android 6.0 device, though, with the most recent one arriving in October. Things seem a little better for the OnePlus 3 and 3T, which got an official upgrade to Oreo over the weekend. There's no telling how long OnePlus will support the 3 and 3T, but so far the support window seems longer than the OnePlus 2. OnePlus told us the 5 and 5T will have an Oreo beta by the end of the year and a final release by Q1 2018. The OnePlus 5, 3T, and 3 have been getting new updates several times a month, which usually arrive in the latest security update. Sometimes these are about a month late, and other times they are on time with the more security-conscious OEMs. OnePlus also seems to go out of its way to ship fixes for high-profile vulnerabilities, like when it shipped the KRACKWPA2 vulnerability in October, making it one of the first OEMs to patch it. OnePlus posts every update release on its website for each device, making update history and release notes very easy to track. While OnePlus makes great hardware and software at a great price, the company often seems determined to shoot itself in the foot with software oversights or anti-consumer moves that generate terrible PR. This month, for instance, it left an engineering APK in its production software that contained a root backdoor. Last month, it was caught collecting personally identifiable analytics data like phone numbers without informing users or asking them if they want to opt in. Earlier this year, the company sent push ads to customers. At the end of its various controversies, OnePlus usually does the right thing. It is issuing an update to remove the engineering APK, it's deleting analytics data and updating phones to requiring an opt-in, and it's allowing users to block the push ads. But why does the company keep doing these things in the first place? OnePlus' continual stream of stupid blunders and lack of concrete update promises makes it hard to trust the company. Right now it feels like OnePlus could do something bad to your software or drop support for the device at any time. So I'll say the same thing I said with the OnePlus 5. The best thing OnePlus can do to improve the outlook of this phone is immediately announce a standard update program with timely monthly updates and 2 years of major update support. If you want to get really technical and install your own software, the OnePlus 5T has an unlockable bootloader, allowing you to replace OnePlus software builds with whatever you want. OnePlus devices are usually extremely popular in the modding community, to the point where modding tools are being released for the OnePlus 5T before it even hits store shelves. I'd expect to see official support from Android's most popular aftermarket ROM, Lineage OS, and tons of ROMs and mods from other developers. Page 2. There's not a ton to say about performance. The OnePlus 5T has the same specs as the OnePlus 5 and exactly the same benchmark scores. It's the same Snapdragon 835 chip we've seen a million times this year, and, again, OnePlus $500 wonder keeps up with the more expensive phones. Even the storage is speedy. Camera. Besides the new screen, buttons, and fingerprint reader, the camera has been changed in the 5T. While the main rear camera is the same as the OnePlus 5T, the secondary rear camera has been changed from a telephoto lens to a camera that specializes in low light. I'm happy to report that this strategy actually works, and in low light you'll get a much brighter picture out of the OnePlus 5T than you would the OnePlus 5. Just going by the specs, there's nothing to indicate that the secondary sensor should be better in low light situations than the first sensor. The main rear camera is a 16MP Sony IMX398 sensor with a 1.12 micrometers pixel size and an f1.7 aperture lens. If you wanted a camera with better low light performance, you could have either a larger pixel size or a wider aperture. Instead, you get neither. The secondary low light camera is a 20MP Sony IMX376K sensor with a smaller 1.0 micrometers pixel size and the same aperture. The difference, then, is all in the software. The low light sensor is a 20MP sensor, but you won't actually get 20MP of clarity out of a dark scene. On the secondary rear camera, OnePlus merges every 4 pixels into a single pixel in a process it has branded Intelligent Pixel Technology, allowing the phone to capture more light. This is kind of like having a larger pixel size sensor, and it really does make a dramatic difference. The 5T can take photos that are a lot brighter than the OnePlus 5. The trade-off is that the image is not as detailed. The camera still pumps out photos with a 20MP resolution, but it's clear they've been heavily processed, since there's all sorts of fuzziness and artifacting at 100%. Do you care that much about viewing a 20MP 5000 by 3800 image at 100%? Though for most smartphone use cases, 20 megapixels is overkill, and on the HD screen of a smartphone or computer, the pictures look great. If given the option, I would definitely take the lower detail, brighter images of the OnePlus 5T over the OnePlus 5. If you're uploading these to Facebook or Instagram or doing some other normal smartphone use case thing with them, you'll be fine. The switching to the secondary low light sensor happens automatically. OnePlus was nice enough to nail down the requirements to exactly 10 lux and under in order for the secondary camera to kick on. In a well-lit room, you can see how this works for yourself by sticking your finger over the main camera. The main camera, since it's covered by your finger, will detect the scene as dark and switch to the secondary camera. The secondary camera can see the light of the well-lit room, so it decides it should turn off and switches back to the main camera. The camera will do this back and forth about once a second. I've got to ask, though, since all the low light magic is in software and both cameras have pretty much the same specs, why not have a single camera that can switch between this single pixel and quad pixel software mode? The main camera, with its slightly larger pixel size, should actually be better in a low light situation if it was given the same software boost. The OnePlus 5T in low light. This is pretty good and is a huge improvement over the OnePlus 5. Zoom in on this and you'll see a severe lack of detail, though, thanks to the pixel doubling. The 5T does much better than this OnePlus 5 shot, which could never get a focus lock and is super dark. The Pixel 2 still picks up more light than the OnePlus 5T and has a lot more detail, since it ISNT effectively cutting the resolution of the image. Outdoor sunlight pictures are pretty easy nowadays, and the OnePlus 5T does fine. At 100%, the Pixel 2 does a better job of capturing detail. The OnePlus 5T does okay in indoor light, but the colors of the plant are a bit extreme. The OnePlus 5 is pretty much identical. The Pixel 2 does a better job with the colors. The dull green leaves are more true to life. A phone that makes you question those $800 flagships. The OnePlus 5 carved itself out a clear spot in the smartphone pricing hierarchy. It was a phone offering high-end specs for a price that was much cheaper than the other high-end phones out there, but this came with some trade-offs in the display and camera department. This was fine, though. The $479 phone couldn't compete with the $800 behemoths out there, and no one expected it to. With the OnePlus 5T upgrading to a slim bezel design, now OnePlus' latest phone really is competing with the highest-end flagship phones. Sure, it got a price bump to $500, but now the line between the OnePlus 5T and the $800 phones is a lot blurrier. design isn't the differentiator anymore, so what is do you care that much about water resistance if you go back and look at the conclusion of our OnePlus 5 review? In the bad categories, we listed the software update situation, the camera, and the design. With the 5T, OnePlus came out and addressed two of these three complaints. When a company fixes some of the biggest flaws in a phone, it's hard not to like the result. The design is every bit on par with the more expensive flagships out there. Heck, sitting on a desk, the phone is almost indistinguishable from a Galaxy S8 or Pixel 2 XL. The metal back is a big upgrade over a glass flagship, and the closet-stock Android build is better than the heavily skinned OS you'd get from LG or Samsung. The camera is improved, the phone has a 3.5mm headphone jack, and even the speaker is pretty good. OnePlus support is the lingering big question mark. The company doesn't have an official update policy, and it has a history of making bad decisions. The company has been doing better with updates lately, but it's hard to trust OnePlus given its track record. We wish the company would just come out and promise a standard 2-year update policy like other OEMs. Without one, buying a OnePlus device means hoping the company sees enough value in supporting you and not dumping you almost immediately like it did to OnePlus 2 owners.